When beams get loaded, they deflect in the direction of loading. This is very intuitive and logical. However, as the load increases, the beam begins to also deflect laterally. This lateral deflection is not as intuitive and requires a deeper investigation. This phenomenon of sideways deflection and twisting is known as lateral-torsional buckling and can be extremely destructive to beams. Lateral-torsional buckling was the cause of the station square collapse in 1988, but we will save this investigation for another time. For now, let's break down why this type of buckling occurs and why is it so fatal for beams. For the geeky part of the audience that enjoys going deeper into technicalities, near the end of this video, we will dive right to the bottom of the physics of this phenomenon to explain the root cause of lateral torsional buckling and the governing equation. For now, let's qualitatively show how lateral torsional buckling occurs. When a simple beam is loaded, the top flange gets compressed while the bottom flange gets stretched. As we displayed in this previous video, when members are compressed, they tend to deflect laterally. For a beam, the situation is slightly more complicated since half of the beam is in compression and half is in tension. For that reason, the top half of the beam wants to buckle due to compression, while the bottom half wants to straighten out due to the pulling slash tensile forces. This tendency of the flanges to move in opposite directions twists the beam, causing it to deflect laterally. Beams that are relatively strong at resisting torsion compared to their bending resistance do not suffer from lateral torsional buckling because their bending strength usually gets exhausted before lateral torsional buckling can be initiated. Such examples are closed sections like pipes or square tubes. Furthermore, these sections have the same stiffness in plane and out of plane and therefore show no tendency to buckle laterally. In contrast, wide flange sections, as we have seen before, are poor at resisting torsional loads. To make things worse, W sections are also generally weaker in bending about their weak axis. This weak axis makes them even more susceptible to lateral torsional buckling. But why is lateral torsional buckling so destructive? Well, taking a closer look at a deflected shape of a buckled beam, we can identify three types of deformations of the section. First, we have the vertical deflection of the beam that is intuitively due to the load application. Secondly, we have the lateral deflection. And lastly, we have the twisting of the section. Each one of these deformations induces stresses in the material. This is where the destructiveness of torsional buckling lies. The load that was initially applied in the direction where the beam is strongest gets propagated to other axes where the beam has very low stiffness. Since the displacement is inversely proportional to the stiffness, it takes a relatively small load to cause large deformations. This is exactly why lateral torsional buckling occurs at a relatively small loads and is followed by large deformations. Based on that, it follows that lateral torsional buckling is most pronounced for sections that are significantly weaker in torsion and bending about the y-axis. Such examples are deep W sections and very slender rectangular beams. These sections are so strong in bending in the direction parallel to the load that the vertical deflection is negligible compared to the buckling and torsional deformations that can happen. On the other hand, for stockier beams, vertical deflection also plays an important role. Stocky beams need special attention because they would most likely experience premature yielding of the material and would fail in combined stability and material failure mode. The yielding, in this case, occurs due to the fact that when the beam is laterally buckled, it undergoes cross-bending, that it's simultaneously bent about the X and Y axis. This biaxial bending causes significant damage to the flange tips and considerably weakens the section and accelerates buckling. To illustrate the strength reduction due to lateral torsional buckling, we will investigate a wide flange beam and compare its capacity. We will compare the same wide flange beam for three different scenarios. First, a simple beam with a point load at midspan applied at the centroid of the section. Next, the same simple beam with a point load at midspan applied at the centroid of the top flange. And lastly, the same simple beam with a point load at midspan but also with regular lateral bracings. The buckling analysis was performed in Abacus for an 8-meter long beam. the following failure loads were obtained for each scenario. The clear winner from the comparison is the braced beam, which could not deflect laterally and therefore achieved its full bending capacity, in essence achieving material failure rather than becoming prematurely unstable. An experiment was also conducted comparing the tendency for lateral torsional buckling between open and closed sections. To ensure the same amount of material, both sections were constructed out of two channel sections. We know that this introduces other issues like shear flow, but with adequate fastener spacing, these effects were successfully minimized. When the box section was loaded, nearly all of the deformations were in the direction of loading, as expected. As the load increased, yielding and local buckling of the top flange could be noticed due to the channels acting separately between fastener locations. But still, no lateral deflections were present. Finally, the beam collapsed at around 72 kilos or 160 pounds in what seemed to be a combination of yielding and local buckling. In contrast, the I section displayed a very different behavior. At around 36 kilos or 80 pounds, a slight lateral deflection started to appear. As the load was increased to 40 kilos and later 42 kilos, the lateral deflection was apparent. The beam failed soon after when the load was increased to 45 kilograms or around 100 pounds. From the footage, it is clear that this was a different type of failure and at a much lower load. Even though both beams used the same amount of material, the box beam achieved a 60% higher capacity compared to the I section. The good thing about lateral torsional buckling is that it's relatively easy to deal with. The most common solution is to laterally brace the compression flange of the beam. This way, the beam is held in place and it can reach its full bending capacity without stability issues. In some situations, for single beams or warehouse cranes, lateral bracing is not easily achievable. In that case, engineers are required to carefully select the type of section used and ensure the beam will not get unstable before reaching its capacity. But what is the actual cause of this instability? The root cause of lateral torsional buckling is the imperfect manufacturing and construction process. This is nothing new, and it is true for any material. Even though not visible, when beams get installed, they are already slightly bent. When a load is applied to them, this imperfection gets amplified. At this stage, the beam is in a position where it is experiencing bending moments or torque around all three of its axes. As mentioned before, if the beam is particularly strong in resisting torsion and bending about the y-axis, or it is laterally braced, then the process of lateral torsional buckling will halt here. However, if none of these conditions are true, then the beam will continue to deflect laterally. More lateral deflection will induce even more bending, which will quickly degenerate into an unstable beam, or in essence, a failure. Here, we can also see why having the load applied at the top of the beam makes things worse. The additional horizontal eccentricity between the centroid of the beam and the load application further increases the bending about the z-axis, or torsional load, and accelerates the buckling process. Since lateral torsional buckling, among other things, is load-specific, design codes around the world have had trouble fully capturing its effects with one equation. Many codes usually rely on the equation derived for a beam subjected to end moments. This equation is comprised of two main terms that contribute to the buckling resistance of the beam, that is, the torsional and warping stiffness of the beam. To extend its utility to multiple cases, design codes add a modification factor that accounts for different bending moment distributions, but still, this equation has many limitations. Besides the torsional capacity, bending resistance about the weak axis, and the point of load application, there are also other factors that influence lateral torsional buckling. For example, less symmetric sections have stress amplification factors that cause localized stress concentrations and accelerate buckling. If the end conditions do not fully restrain the twisting of the beam, the critical load is further lowered. A varying bending moment diagram, the slenderness of the beam, and the load type could also impact the buckling susceptibility. As engineers, we constantly evaluate many possible failure scenarios and account for different factors so that we can design safe structures. This type of thinking takes a while to develop on its own. But luckily, Brilliant has courses designed for exactly this type of thinking. Brilliant trains you to think critically through a set of interactive courses that you can complete at your own pace, at home, on a flight, or on the bus. Interactive learning helps you learn 6 times more effectively than watching lecture videos online. Complex STEM topics are broken down into fun and interactive exercises that help you gain deep understanding and obtain real problem-solving skills. To get started for free, visit brilliant.org/theengineeringhub or click on the link in the description, and the first 200 of you will get 20% off Brilliant's annual premium subscription. Thanks for watching. We would love to hear from you in the comment section. Let us know how well you managed to understand the content presented and if there were sections that you feel could have been explained better. If you enjoyed the video, consider also subscribing to our channel, and see you next time.